evening. Headed over to the Move Me Brightly concert being held at Bob Weir's TRI Studios. It's in honor of Jerry Garcia's 70th birthday. Gonna be a bunch of great people playing there. Pretty excited about it. Looking forward to it. A little lost because I'm not concentrating. Got too excited about the show, now I'm lost. Called Bob, he gave me directions. Kind of gave me those directions that you give somebody that's already been there before, and I've not been there before. Thanks, Bob. No, we're gonna find it here in a second. He lost me at the second set of train tracks. He said, take a left. Say, sir, I'm real sorry. I'm just, I'm looking around for, sorry, for Bob Weir's studio.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Do you know where it is?
No, I was just going off these directions and I
but
can't.
But why are
really
you looking for it? Do you know Bob? Are you friends with Bob?
I wouldn't say I'm friends. I'm just helping out on this Jerry Garcia.
He wouldn't be upset if, like, if you came walking up, you know, or something? Or
no,
I
believe so. Yeah.
But if I send you up there, they're not going to throw you out, and then somebody goes, well, you know.
Oh, no, yeah? Not at all.
Yeah, no. You're not doing no eBay thing or nothing like that?
No, sir. I think they're actually expecting me.
Yeah. Wow, cool. Well, Bob's my buddy, and I just don't want to, you know. Uh-huh. So all I got to do is turn around and look right behind you. That studio's right over there, dude.
It's right there.
Thanks. You're not really that lost. You just appear to be.
Thanks very much.
Tell everybody happy birthday to Jerry.
You look very familiar.
I hear that all the time. Man.
Okay. Take it easy.
All right,
thanks.
Cool. Thanks.
Shit, my fly's down.
Guy I knew through all the years. That was the whole deal. You know, the people used to ask, what's your secret? How have you stayed together so long? Well, we kept ourselves in stitches. That's how we did it. I remember one time Jerry, some guest came to a show, and we were backstage hanging in the little guitar tent that we had back there, and just, you know, hanging like crows on a fence, just going back and forth at each other, and this guest came in and had a chance to observe what we were doing, and you know, I think we kind of fried his brain a little bit. And Jerry said it at one point, well, see, you know, the music's, you know, fine and good, but comedy, that's our real deal.
You keep me up just one more night, can't sleep.
Jerry at the Panhandle around 67, and I was taking a solo in this truck like they used to do, and I closed my eyes and I was taking the solo, and when I opened them up, J- Jerry was right there and Michael Bloomfield. And they were looking at me and I was like, oh my God. And it's like Jerry Garcia, Michael Bloomfield, and they're checking me out. And they were smiling like two Buddhas, man, like two Chester Cat Buddhas, man.
Still living at home, probably 13, 14 years old, my dad wanted to play banjo, but he never got a handle on it. And so he put it up for sale for $15, right? Put in the Palo Alto Times, name of the newspaper, Palo Alto. And there was a knock on the door one night, and lo and behold, there was Garcia. And he paid my dad $15 and took the banjo. And it was the first time I ever saw him. I hadn't seen him at the Tangent yet. This was before I saw him play with Mother McCree's. And I remarked with him later about that. You know, I said, hey, Jerry, you remember that? And he laughed. He said, you know what, Bill? That was a good banjo, too. I like playing it.
If it's okay, I'll ask you about
Jerry's finger. Ask away.
Ask away. Okay. Well, I mean, I've got a couple of older brothers, so I know it can be dangerous, but what did happen to Jerry's finger?
Well, I chopped it with an axe. He was putting little pieces of twigs on the sawhorse or whatever, and I was chopping them in half, making kindling. And he did this. Put his finger there, and then he'd take it away. Put his finger there, take it away. That happened a dozen times. Finally, I nailed him, so they had to remove it. So that's the story, in a nutshell.
I mean,
the trauma happened afterwards.
He didn't deserve it, but I can't say it sounds like it was your fault. I mean,
it was my fault because I did it.
Well,
but I wasn't thinking about the consequences. Right. I was just playing the game he wanted me to play.
Right.
Keith and I were, of course, into the Grateful Dead, and one day I came home and I said, listen to some Grateful Dead, and Keith said, I don't want to listen to it anymore, I want to play it. And I said, okay, let's go get in the band. And so we looked in the paper and saw that Jerry's band, the Jerry Garcia Band in that configuration at that time were playing at Keystone Corner in San Francisco. And that's when I tapped Garcia when he was going off stage for a break and said, "My husband and I need to talk to you." And he said, "Come on backstage." And we were too afraid, you know. And the next thing I know, he had come out from the backstage area and was sitting at our table. And he said, "Okay, what is it?" And we just kind of nailed it right there. And really, within a few weeks, we were in the band. But it was very quick and very, if I may say so, very spiritual and very perceptive of Jerry to know that this was something to be investigated and taken seriously. And I don't try this at home, you know.
And the rest is history.
The rest is history.
Pranksters and the uh-huh. Grateful Dead, for somebody uh-huh. like you to kind of move between such interesting uh-huh. groups like that, what was that like for you?
The prankster thing had sort of started to fall apart. You know, we had no money. We were under various kinds of legal difficulties and, you know, upcoming court dates and all that kind of stuff. And we couldn't keep doing what we were doing. The bus went right back to Oregon, and I was in San Francisco, and so it was an easy thing to go over to where they were living on Ashbury Street and say, "Hey, you know, what's up?" And Jerry and I just naturally fell into each other's arms, as it were. That's, yeah.
What was the relationship like between your father and Jerry? I mean, I kind of know vaguely about them, you know, kind of meeting back, kind of, I think,
right
around the acid test. Would that have been when they first met? Or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. I think so. They were friends, and they were both very heady and very funny and had a great time being the center of attention. Right. And so, you know, I think they're compatriots in the land of weirdness.
You have a great story about when you saw him playing with Mother McCree's Uptown Jug Champions. What
really, oh, yeah.
What jumped out at you?
I was lucky that night. I got to sit right in front of Jerry in the very front row. It was just a bunch of chairs and tables. It was a coffee house. And I sat right in front and watched Jerry play, and it was amazing how he held the audience in his hand. Everybody in the place was just his, mesmerized by him, including me. And I swear I'm the first Deadhead, honest to God, first Deadhead ever. And everybody out there can debate this, but in that moment when I watched him play, I said, "I'm going to follow this guy forever." And then about 2 weeks later, he calls me and says, "Hey, you want to get together and play?" And that was the beginning of the Grateful Dead.
Interesting that he would get off the road, and this is just from what I've read, and, you know, play all around San Francisco, and there's, you know, like Sausalito and Marin and all these different towns. Yeah. I just like the idea of someone, you know, not saying like, oh, I don't want to pick up a guitar. He would go kind of right.
Yeah,
kind of
he was a workaholic. You know, really for him, his very existence was based on music. And if he wasn't playing, I think he felt lost. He had to play all the time, even in his little apartment, little tiny one-room apartment that we lived in when he wasn't on the road. It was never fancy. He just would sit in his chair with his practice instrument and watch TV. We'd watch movie after movie after movie and talk all the while he's playing scales and all the while he's, you know, in that mode.
To put together the show, and then I left her on tour, and then they put our management here made a lot of phone calls, started saying, you know, this guy wants to play, how about that? Sure, bring him on.
So when I got the call, it was kind of obvious that I would love to come and just be part of this, and then that they get 10 or so legends of indie or whatever it is, that all different kinds of people, really like hip, cool, interesting people, you know, it's really so tasteful.
For a really long time, and I know the melodies, and I know the songs, and I know what the songs are in my head, but it's quite a different thing when you approach them from a musical standpoint, trying to play them. That's where a lot of us get really tripped up, because they just seem like these simple tunes and they're these universal songs that we all know and love. And but when you actually try to play them, it can be really difficult.
you know, I think it's important to bring in what you have to say about it. And hopefully, if you're really lucky and you're particularly inspired, maybe you can play something that somebody hadn't thought of playing in the last 40 years on some of these tunes. And when if that can happen, then you really feel like you're adding to the vocabulary. It's a living and breathing thing as opposed to a museum piece. And I think Grateful Dead music in particular, because of the improvisational component, it would be a real disservice to to recreate and freeze it in time and never have it continue on and inspire new ideas, new thoughts. And I think that's really important.
It was like watching the movie or the play unfold in a brand new village, more populous. Same story, but the characters were oftentimes just younger, different. It was an infusion of a whole new energy, not so much energy as a whole new light on the subject. It was like, you know, a remake of an old movie, but it was a good remake. It was it held together, had integrity. It was wonderful.
We had 11 hours of practice yesterday. And my friends at home were saying, oh my God, sorry you had to. And I was like, sorry, this is amazing. This is Grateful Dead camp.
That's, Bill's hitting the third.
That was probably a fuck up.
No, every time he does it on the first half of the chorus.
That might be a fuck up.
And on Reckoning.
I grew up having my soul and my heart and my heartstrings strummed to that music. And here we are. And once, I mean, it might start out a little amorphous, and then we bring the volume down, and we bring the focus in, and I was getting chills for the whole 11 hours.
There's a certain depth, in my opinion, to these tunes that you have to connect with if you're going to play them with any kind of, I don't know, meaning, you know, or soul. You have to spend some time with them.
What are the memories that stick out of your father? Because you, as you said, you were young when he passed away, like being on tour and like growing up with him. And
we were at Four Seasons, I believe, and Massachusetts when I was about 5, and somebody pulled the fire alarm, and I was shaken up by it. There wasn't an actual fire. I was being a big sissy about it, and I was scared. So my dad gave me one of his big black t-shirts to wear. And actually, it's kind of weird, but I've like kept that t-shirt under my pillow like ever since. And I like feel like if it's not like tucked in just the right way under my pillow, then I'm gonna have nightmares. And I'm just, it's a little bit of my superstition, but.
Nice.
Is that really nice?
I think it's really cool. Wish I had one.
Aw, I'll give you one. I probably have a spare. Yeah. I'll cut mine in half and give you half.
I'm lucky if I have a pillow.
Aw.
Usually just using an elbow.
I think Jerry Garcia's image in punk rock world LA 1979 was that guy's far out. He's so far outside of the normal spin of the world that, you know, you had to kind of respect him. Even though I don't even know that we thought about, you know, the whole Grateful Dead world at that point. But it was, you can see, you know, what Jim Morrison was like. He spun a different way than the world did, and I think everybody had a kind of guarded respect.
These are in Jerry's hand. This is a typical set list that he would write. As I would take his gear down, I always kept a set list. So this is probably, what this is from, I realize, is
a solo show of him and John Kahn. Now, this is Jerry's song list in his hand for the Garcia Band. Mission in the Rain, They Love Each Other, Stir It Up, Don't Let Go, Ride the Mighty High, Stop That Train. He would always say, I'm not that special. There's a million guys that can play the guitar like I can. And I said, well, I've never heard one yet, but you are a guitar player. He was that, he knew that. And so he always identified with that in stragglers and people that were outcasts of society, as he called them, freaks. You know, he liked that. If you were weird, he liked it. The weirder the better sometimes.
The first concert that I actually did see him was at the Fillmore. And it was the Grateful Dead, the Great Society, and Country Joe and the Fish. And I was like, damn, you know, I'm still in high school and looking at the light show and the music and everything, you know. I thought it was like some kind of gumbo, electric gumbo.
It was 1981, and they were performing the other one. And here's these guys that looked like anyone coming off the street creating this effect that was so palpable simply through their music, standing there, looking at each other, listening and playing. And, you know, when it goes to another level, that's something that you can't help but be affected strongly by. So, and there was Jerry peering at the rest of the band over the top of the rims of his eyeglasses and just weaving this spell. And it was beautiful. And that was it. I got it then.
Coming from the punk rock world, them being part of the, you know, the psychedelic world, it's like we still understood subculture. Mm-hmm. We still understood being, you know, sticking it to the man. We still understood that, you know, corporate was bullshit, and we still understood all that stuff. So we kind of like, yeah, but we're not into that jamming thing, you know. And but I had no idea what the subculture was like. I saw Dylan and the Dead in Anaheim, and I thought, I get it. Now I get it, because also a big Bob Dylan fan. And it was, I just loved the whole audience thing and everything that was going on. So I was like, okay, the Grateful Dead, and they haven't recorded a record in how many years? And they haven't worked with a major company in how many years? And they just like let all their fans record all their shit on cassette recorders? What? This is really sticking it to the man.
It's just super that a human being or a human being and his pals could make an alternative world that was, you know, being lived simultaneous to the rest of the world. And it was a world where you could be freer, sloppier, sillier, happier. That's really hard to do.
It was just wonderful to be so welcomed when you went on stage or getting ready, and to see people really care about getting into the shows and I Need a Miracle and all that good stuff. It was really refreshing, especially when you played in a city which is all gray and buildings, and you get closer to the gig site, the hall, whatever it was, and you start seeing all these tie-dyes. It was just like this beautiful ocean of color washing into this venue, and you knew you were going to the right place for sure. And it was just a brightening, and the audience always made me feel a lot lighter, and I wanted to give a lot more to it.
Did we ever go to a show together?
Me and Jay, man, it was a great day.
Yeah.
You know, running around in the parking lot.
Yeah. So you're immersed in a scene. It's not necessarily, I mean, sure, everybody, the highlight of the night of the day is when they play, but the day itself is kind of a highlight of the year.
Exactly.
Because you're immersed in a scene, and it's kind of like you're there for hours just letting your body and your mind enjoy itself.
I would imagine it could maybe be difficult as his child to have so many people drawn to him. And I think it is because kind of the kindness and generosity kind of came through, just what a genuine person he is. But I could also imagine that could kind of wear on you as a child to have so many people kind of drawn to him.
Yeah, it's been kind of a competition between me and the Deadheads for time.
Right.
You know, I remember at Oakland Coliseum, we used to try and go out and like not scalping tickets, but trade tickets for things, like weed or swag or whatever. I was young, and I was like, and trying to strike a deal with a hippie, and I was like, hey, I'm one of Jerry's kids. And he's like, we're all Jerry's kids. And I was like, fuck.
Actually, no, I really mean it.
No, they didn't even buy it. There was no coming back. Right. It was just like, peace out, we're all Jerry's kids. Like, duh.
I think he kind of regretted not being able to walk down the street and be anonymous. But he got hit, you know. He would have had to go to China to be anonymous by that time. So, as an easily recognizable freak, he attracted an awful lot of attention. And as you know, as and also a San Francisco boy, you know, he was from San Francisco, so he loved his city.
Right.
He knew all the back ways through town, you know, how to get through town when traffic was bad. And so he always taught San Francisco. And I think it was tough for him to be so recognizable.
I turn and walk away, and I come round again. You know it looks as though tomorrow I'll do pretty much the same. I must turn down your offer. Though I'd like to ask one break, you know I'm ready to give anything for everything I take. Walking along in the
I think it was 84, maybe. We were playing at New George's in San Rafael. Jerry showed up, Jerry and Merle. And it just so happens that, since we're in the neighborhood, Carlos Santana showed up too. It was, you know, it was a big night for the Lobos and for myself, you know. Before Jerry left, he tells me, he says, I got a 58 Strat. I said, wow, that's cool, but you know, I can't afford that, you know. He goes, no, I want you to have it. It was, I mean, I couldn't believe it, you know, so. About 6 months later, we were playing at the Warfield, and Jerry came to the show, and he came backstage before we went on and would say hello. So I invited him up to play, and he shows me his tickets. He goes, nah, man, I came to see a show. You know? So they were leaving, and the last guy to leave hands me this old tweed case, and there it was. It was a 58 Strat, you know. It felt like a friendship, you know, and I believe it was. We didn't get to see each other very often, but when we did, it was cool. We got to hang out a little. And I'll always, you know, cherish that friendship, you know, and, you know, means a lot to me. I miss him.
Jerry's only kind of gone, for me at least. When I'm playing, I can hear him. You know, I can hear the harmonics. I don't hear actual melodies, but I can hear his harmonic, his harmonics, I can feel his harmonic sense and develop, and I can hear the development that's going on, and I can chase it, or I can pull away from it and not exactly reject it, but go counter to it, which, you know, we fought on stage, and sometimes we were lovey-dovey on stage. When we fought on stage, it usually the purpose was to create tension. You know, art is tension and release. Thank you.
To a party one year, the night that I played with your dad on New Year's in Maui. Papa Molly was there and a bunch of people, and Jerry was on his version of Knocking on Heaven's Door was playing. And it sounded beautiful, and we were just sitting there, and I saw this, and it ended up just being me and this other girl. And all of a sudden, she just lets out a wail. And just starts breaking down crying like I've never seen anybody crying before, except for maybe if their parent had just died, or you know, their you know, son had just died, or you know, it's like really intense. And I grabbed her, I said, "Are you okay?" And she just, you know, kept wailing and gave me a hug and just held me, and she said, "I can't believe he's gone," you know. And this was like 3 years, this was 15 years after he died, you know. That was the first time I had witnessed the kind of, the way that he had touched people.
And after that, the coma, it always seemed incredible to me that he had to kind of relearn the guitar. Mm-hmm. And I'd read that Merle Saunders spent lots and lots of time
absolutely
just kind of going over it with him. And I can't imagine how, I mean, scary for somebody like that was such a virtuoso like your dad to have to think, gosh, will I be able to do this again?
Right. It worked, but I remember very vividly living with him during that time and him just looking at his hands and, you know, just breathing, just taking these big breaths going, yeah, you know, I can do this. It's all here.
Oh,
it's all in there. All that muscle memory is there. It's just the access was gone. So the first instrument he picked up after all this was the banjo, because that was his very first instrument. And he was like playing the banjo to trying to control a train wreck,
right.
You know, because it is a madness. And with him missing the finger,
right,
he had his own style,
right,
of course. So that was his, you know, if I can play the banjo, everything else is going to fall in line. And so, I mean, you've never seen a man sweat
you know, and turn gray, just sitting there trying to pick something very simple. And I mean, it was a heartbreaking, inspiring thing to see how fierce he was about it. I'd never seen him fierce before, and this was something that was all from inward.
Not that he was a laid-back guy, but obviously driven in a lot of ways, but to see somebody, like you were saying, like that, get fierce, had to have been kind of interesting.
It was intimidating. You walked very softly in that house. Right. You know, you're like, okay, there's something really intense going on in that room. I need to just, and I was only 16 at the time, so you're already a teenager, and so you're already sensitive in your teenage ways. And so having that going on, I think in a large way really taught me to bite onto things and to not shy away and to work as hard as I can, work as hard as he did, and just getting back what he'd lost. I mean, it was a transformative moment for him, absolutely, yeah.
Ran in a train ditch, caught on a limb. Like I told you what I said, steal your face right off your head. Now he's
we
strange. Maybe off in some hot cold mountain train. Lost one while, but the price wasn't anything. And I think about more of the same.
Jerry has been so threaded in our lives through the music that we love, and then playing Ripple on Dedicated. This is a fact. Jerry Garcia, in the Rolling Stone interview, they asked him what they think about Dedicated. He goes, I like Jane's Addiction's version of Ripple. And, you know, that was just a moment in my life. And then later in the interview, they said, what do you think about 90s music, Living Color, or some of the other bands? He goes, I like Jane's Addiction. This is Jerry Garcia saying
this. Yeah, I remember you were happy, but what made you happy was you were saying to me, my brother read that.
I know, he did. My brother.
You were really proud that your big brother.
It was his moment. My brother, and I always was a Bobby guy because Bobby rocked a little harder as a youngster. And then as I grew up, I just started to appreciate the Jerry tunes. And then my brother did pass away. He was part of the Ripple experience. And then years later, Jerry died on my mom's birthday, August 9th. And all my brother's friends called my mom to say, Jerry's with Mark. And she's like, you're not going to believe it. It's my birthday. So all these people started calling our house on Jerry's death, my mom's birthday.
I must say that Jerry is an incredible legend, but Bob is too. And Bob keeps talking this whole week, sitting us down and having great pep talks about how the story is the face of the song. And when he's saying that to us, and we've had two long examples of him just sitting with the 20 of us in the room, and when he's saying that, the amazing thing is he practices what he preaches to such a high level.
It was a lot of work. We did days and days of rehearsal and stuff like that, and even remembered some of the arrangements that we came up with. But it went long. We had no idea how much it was going to amount to. It just kept building and growing and
about it too, up until the rehearsal. I mean, just to stand next to Bob Weir, and he means a whole lot to me also, and had a big influence on me as well. So this is definitely one of those real lifetime highlights for me.
Bob Weir is one of the most inspiring guys like I've ever met. It's a very evolved thing to be that guy that like supports Jerry and just, you know, gets in there at the right spots. And you know, the thing that I love about these guys is that they're not scared to jam and for the thing to go somewhere else like completely, and like they're there, man. Like there's no preconceived thing like this should end now, or this should go here now, because it always went there now. Like, that's a special thing.
You know, we got to stand next to the guy who helped create this, who's one of the main creators of this kind of music, this kind of approach, this kind of thinking.
We're storytellers. We do it with our fingers, we do it with our voices, but we're all storytellers. And that story that's being told by the lead singer is the face of the song. If you start to lose that, the song loses focus. It's just so much organized noise. But once that story is being told, once those bells are being rung, we're making history with every note. And that's what a musician does. That's what a musician lives for.
Homeland.
We'll be right back.
Did you ever get the impression that Jerry would have been anything but a musician? Did he ever think about, you know, getting a regular job?
No, I don't think so.
Just always driven?
Yeah, as soon as he got the guitar, I think he was driven to do that and learn more of that. He was never a laborious type.
Jerry's got his own style. Well, I remember somebody told me when you listen to his guitar playing, it feels like it's just coming up from a babbling brook, you know, some stream, you know, in some forest, and it just trickles into the music, you know, his guitar playing, and his tone is immaculate, you know.
Jerry's music is very powerful because when a lot of musicians, guitar players were coming from the B.B. King ocean and Buddy Guy and Otis Rush and Chicago, Albert King, Freddie King, you know. Jerry was more like a salmon that was going upstream. His runs were different. You know, it was always like, it's always moving.
I remember when we played Laguna Seca, we did our show and he says, hey, nice set, you know. And I said, yeah, you know. I told him, you know, mistakes and all. And he said, nothing ventured, nothing gained. And so I lived by that, you know. He went for it. You know, he was always taking it somewhere. And it was, you know, sometimes it wasn't pretty, you know, but it was always different.
I always noticed that Jerry Garcia had a very specific tone. You know, Carlos Santana has a specific tone. And I like the fact that he didn't play a lot of notes, but they had weight. Mm-hmm. Everything he played, he felt and thought about.
I came into the rock and roll scene pretty much as a folky, and sort of was learning on the job kind of stuff. But Jerry had played in bands a lot, obviously, and you know, and I always looked to him to find out what would make me a better band player sometimes. One of the things, remember I started to learn some different chords, you know, other than the finger-picking chords that I use, because the rock chords are a little bit different than that, and thrashing around and doing all this stuff. And I'm going, what do you think about this, you know? He ruminated on it for a while, and he says, it's what you don't play that's really important.
At the time I got this guitar, I couldn't afford an acoustic guitar. I had one electric guitar, and we were playing in Mud Crutch back in Florida. And we got a gig up in Georgia, I think, opening for Mitch Ryder and the Detroit Wheels, if you can believe that. So we went up and played the gig. And afterwards, we were packing up our gear, and this kid came up, and he said, I want to give you my guitar. And I said, well, why would you want to do that? You know, and he goes, because your playing inspired me. And he goes, you know, I'm a real Jerry Garcia fan, and I heard some Jerry Garcia feeling in your playing, which is interesting because I was learning how to play, and I listened to a lot of Jerry Garcia, and I learned some scales and phrasing from him. There was a song on the first album called Mystery Man, which I liked a lot. It's not a hit, but it's one of my favorite songs. Tom wrote this song, and he had a rhythm like, I'd been listening to Jerry Garcia a lot, who I really love the way he plays, and I thought if it had like a low guitar line and his sort of soul, it might sound good, and we came up with this. Uh, And it worked really good with his parts.
It sneaks through in my playing sometimes, or in songwriting. Some aspect will come through in a song or something. I'll hear it and I'll go, all right, you know. I was listening, I did learn something, you know.
He was constantly seeking forward, but behind everything he played was a lyricism and a pathos that was just him bearing his soul. When he was in his best, he was really leading the band by following the band. And he was opening up his soul and letting music play through him.
There's things that he plays at the same time that he sings that are just like mind-blowing. Like me, I'm going like, is that like someone else playing that bit? Yeah, but no, it's him. Like, you know, he's just, you know, mastery is what it is and stuff.
Thank you. stands today. You decide if he was wise. The storyteller makes no choice. Soon you will not hear his voice. His job is to shed light and not to master.
Thank you.
Well, I think Jerry would be smiling, you know. This is a fun thing. And, you know, it's Jerry Garcia Day at the baseball field. I don't know. It's a fun thing. He liked fun. He was always smiling. So he'd like it.
Here we go. Left, right over here. AT&T Park, Jerry Garcia, right here. Jerry Garcia rocks.
Jerry Garcia, the leader of the band. Inspiration, move me right. Jerry Garcia was the guy who was able to lift everyone's spirits, to bring them together.
It's a phenomenon that will probably never be duplicated again ever, and it's really hard to quantify, and maybe it doesn't need to be quantified, but, you know, I remember when Jerry and the guys had Ol' Impaly, there was a time when we were up there one day, it was me, Jack, and everybody was up there, but there was a conversation between me, Jack, Janice, and Jerry, and Janice and I were talking about how long it would take, because we were such blues fanatics at that time, you know, before we'd be considered to be authentic by our peers, you know, and I remember, I'll never forget this, Jerry said, we're going to be archetypes, you know, and that came through in a way that may not have totally pleased him later on in life, but I think it absolutely did come true. I mean, he was such a charismatic character, and he didn't set out, I don't think, I mean, not for me to say what Jerry set out to do, but I don't think he set out to do that. That's just who he was, and there was something about him that people loved. They just really loved that, and whatever it was that the Grateful Dead had and brought to the table, it lasted for so many years and still lasts. You just can't measure that. You can't even describe it. I mean, it's one of these things that we all understand because we've seen it. And it's like, how can that happen? I mean, you can't create that. You can't architect something like that.
We love you, Jerry, and we miss you.
Don't you push me, baby, 'cause I'm moaning low. Well, I know something you won't never know.
And to this very day, I carry his picks in my pocket in case I get run over by a bus and I have to meet him again. The first thing he's going to ask me for is a pick, because that is what he expected. With Jerry, it was forever.
My most transcendent Dead moment ever was with one of their newer songs, which was hearing The Days Between in, I think it was in 1994 at Nassau Coliseum of all places. And I'd seen them a number of times, and I'd seen the Jerry Band too. And I'd had some good moments, but something happened that night when they went into The Days Between, the entire earth started spinning slower, and the whole universe seemed to shift in some way that I can't really put into words. Almost 20 years later, to have things come around, to be on the same stage, you know, with Bob, Jerry gone, of course, you know, and to have Bob singing those words and to be standing right next to him, playing those chords, those changes, you know. And yeah, as we played that song, that same feeling came back to me, and to hear him delivering those lyrics was a really, really big deal to me.
There were days between. Summer flies and August dies, and the world grows dark in me. Comes the shimmer of the moon, on dark infested trees, singing man is at his song, timid plead their plea. No one knows much more of this.
Thank you.
like a golden bowl. Brightest ever seen. Hearts of summer held in trust.
tell you where the four winds sleep. Like Moline House, the lighthouse keep. While farmers sing in the sand and wind, may the four winds blow you safely home again.
So what do you think Jerry would be up to if he was around for his 70th?
He'd be doing the same thing. He'd be playing, doing drugs, whatever. You know, he was just into stuff. He was obsessed with anything.
Playing somewhere, maybe two or three shows with all these people. I think he'd be totally touched at all the great talent of the next generation.
Just having the best time. He'd probably want to be playing music, knowing him. He always played music. Whenever I saw him, in a hotel room, wherever, he always had a guitar in his hand playing. So that's what he would be doing. He liked to play.
What would he be doing? Hopefully he'd be coming down to sit in with us tonight.
Exactly. Or maybe he'd be trying to avoid it because everybody else would be making a big deal out of it. Who knows, you know, who knows? But, you know, he'd be glad to make 70, I'm sure. Yeah.
I will say that the one thing my dad always wanted to do, but never could pull it off for some reason, he always wanted to do a duet with Dolly Parton.
No kidding.
He was absolutely in love with her.
They should have done Islands.
I totally agree. I have often wondered what life would have been like had we gone Southern at some point. But he talked about her all the time. When I would ask him, well, who, you know, duet wise, what would you want? He's Dolly Parton every time. 70th birthday present, I would have tried to get him Dolly Parton.
That's a great idea.
I think it's kind of nice to have a nice celebration for a guy that isn't necessarily that kind of guy that would kind of, you know, welcome with open arms a big celebration of his birthday. So
right.
I think it's particularly nice.
He liked having get-togethers. I doubt he would want it to be about him, but, you know, c'est la vie. He ain't here to say no, so.
Gosh, I mean, is it politically correct to say he'd be partying like me?
Kidding?
All right, good. Yeah, I think he'd be partying. I mean, that was one of the beauties of Jerry Garcia. We all die sometime, and I'm sure that he died feeling that he did what he wanted to do with his body and his life. And I think that when you have those thoughts going into death, you can't help but die happy.
I used to say to him, Jerry, what are we going to do when we're 70? I did ask him that, and he said, I'm going to be on a street corner playing guitar, and you're going to be passing the hat around, getting the nickels and making sure that people don't take any money out. And I said, yep, that'll be us. And so I swear to God, we really had that conversation.
He shows up in my dreams a lot, maybe every night. So it's not like I miss him all that much. I miss the laughs, though I do get to laugh when I'm sleeping every now and again when I'm dreaming. Yeah.
Hey,
evening. Headed over to the Move Me Brightly concert being held at Bob Weir's TRI Studios. It's in honor of Jerry Garcia's 70th birthday. Gonna be a bunch of great people playing there. Pretty excited about it. Looking forward to it. A little lost because I'm not concentrating.
You know, we landed in this helicopter and we saw this living ocean of hair and teeth and eyes and arms, and we were like, oh my God. First person I see is Jerry, and he's looking like a shaman wisdom dude, man, in the middle of all these people, and you know, he's smiling like, and I said, hey, how you doing, man? He said, what, you know, how you doing? He goes, what time are you guys gonna go on? I said, well, we're supposed to go on like 2 hours after you guys. And he started laughing. He goes, well, man, you're gonna be going on like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, because we're going on like, apparently the schedule is kind of weird, so we're gonna be on like 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock in the morning. I said, really? Okay, then I'm just, let's see, it's 12 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 o'clock in the morning. He goes, and then he smiles, you know, and someone suggested, you know, just taking some LSD or peyote, whatever the hell it was, you know. I'm like, okay, that sounds really good. By the time I go play, I'll be able to, like, you know, go like this. You know, because usually when you take acid, it's all like, you know, like amoeba with colors. And when I do play, 12 hours or 7 hours after I take the stuff, it feels really genuine. It feels really like giving birth to light. It's not notes and it's not intellect, you know. So yeah, this was, and so he smiled, he's like, smiles like, okay, you know. So the next thing I know, I took it. And within 2 hours, someone comes over like this and he goes, if you don't play now, you're not gonna play it at all. I was like, oh, damn, you know. I think it was at the same time he said, there's no place to hide. So I was like, I don't need to hide from anybody, you know. I don't run away, hide, or escape, man. So, you know, but I remember him saying, he was just laughing, there's no place to hide, you know. That performance at Woodstock was a real challenge. It's the first time that I got really, 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 really close to God. One to Jerry Garcia, and one because I kept saying to God, look, I promise I'll never take this stuff again. Please help me to stay in tune and in time and know what I'm doing. Because, you know, right now I was like, and it was in front of 500,000 people, man. That was one of the funniest parts, because he participated in my expansion of consciousness. And I'm grateful to him for it. It's like a teacher. He was just always very encouraging, very, very inspiring and encouraging to me.
Thank you.
sang a little while, and then flew off. Don't cry now.
something like a bird within her sight.
Spend a little time on the mountain. strong. Baby, find out before too long. One way or another, one way or another, will this darkness got to give?
Baby, baby. So before we go on to our next song, David Crosby sent a poem that he wanted to be read tonight. It's called, "'Cause I'm Missing Him Tonight." If I had to pick one of us to speak for us all, he would have done the job well. Coming from some crazy angle, he'd have known which story to tell. He'd tell the truth about real music. He knew the truth long before he fell. His fingers would touch his guitar neck. My axe would be pressed to my chest. A chord and a melody would walk in the door, closely followed by all the rest. Magic and tragic and triumph and storm, and all the things we had sought on our quest. You get your ego out of the way of your hearts. The whole becomes greater than the sum of the parts. A sort of field pops into existence. Everything lifts off the ground. You know that you're doing what you were born to do, that you're using the gift that you found to create some lift and break all the chains with which all our people are bound. He did it for all the right reasons and made all our mistakes. A more human man you could not find, an accelerator without the brakes. But he had the brains and the heart and the spirit. Garcia really had what it takes. Trailed by 20 hounds. Didn't get to sleep last night till the morning came around. Said I'll run, but I take my time. Friend of the devil is a friend of mine. If I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight. Ran into the devil, baby, loan me 20 bills. Spent the night in Utah in a cave up in the hills. Said I'll run, but I take my time. Friend of the devil is a friend of mine. I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight. Ran down to the levee, but the devil caught me there. Took my $20 bill and it vanished in the air. Said I'm running, but I take my time. Friend of the devil is a friend of mine. I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight. Got two reasons why I cry awake each lonely night. First one's named Sweet Amarin, she's my heart's delight. Second one is the prison bait, Sheriff's on my trail. And if he catches up with me, I'll spend my life in jail. Got a wife and she know, babe, one in Cherokee. First one says she got my child, but it don't look like me. Said I'll run, but I take my time. Friend of the devil is a friend of mine. If I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight. Thank you.
Got two reasons why I cry and wake each lonely night. First one's named Sweet Amory, and she's my heart's delight. Second one is prison babe, and sheriff's on my trail. And if he catches up with me, I'll spend my life in jail. Got a wife and she no babe, and one in Cherokee. First one says she got my child, but it don't look like me. Sit down, run about it, take my time. Friend of the devil is a friend of mine. I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight. You can borrow from the devil, babe. You can borrow from a friend. Devil give you $20 bill, friend, only got 10. Said I'll run, I'm gonna take my time. Friend of the devil is a friend of mine. I get home before daylight, just might get some sleep tonight.
There it is. Yep, this is the first, it's the first Dead record I ever had. That image there, you know, you never forget that once you see it. As a kid, I always wondered, I was like, what does that mean, you know? And this is where my world kind of opened up. The opening of this record was the opening of my young world. Oh yeah, I mean, look at that. There's more madness. Oh well, yeah, too, that, you know. The whole wall of sound thing. I would look at that for hours and be like, whoa. There you have it. It changed my life forever.
Went to see the captain, strangest I could find. Laid my proposition down,
blow all that could not sink or swim was just left that afloat.
Ship of food.
Well, you know, Ship of Fools, it's one of those great, great dead songs. Those lyrics, they say a lot, you know? In a short amount of time, there's not a lot of verses to that tunes, to that song. There's just, it just nails it. It's one of those songs that just nails it. Mm-hmm. And the original Dead version, or the way they played it, it had that mystical quality that I really connect to. The song, yeah, it's just one of those songs I could really relate to. And it's one of those songs that I've always felt that I can own that. I can sing that one, you know, because it's not the case with everything. There's a lot of great songs that we all love, but not everyone can sing them. There's plenty of songs that I love that I wouldn't touch, you know. But for whatever reason, Ship of Fools, to me, I feel like, all right, this one's mine. You know, I can bring something to this, you know.